Welcome back to another video here on this channel, and I think I call this one Let It Go. What I mean by that is, actually with my last video about wavetable synthesis, a lot of people jumped into this discussion, it's not because my video, it's people really wanted to recreate Serum, the sound of Serum inside Bitwig Studio to 100%, so you can compare it and phase flip two sounds, and then they completely cancel each other out and so on. And inside the Polygrid you have oversampling, and outside don't, and so on. So a lot of people are pretty obsessed with sound accuracy to other things and so on, and that's perfectly fine. I have no problem with that. Sometimes it's pretty interesting to actually feature compare certain devices and the plugins and so on. But my topic of this video is Let It Go, and these things don't matter in the real world when you create music, in my opinion. So, for instance, wavetable synthesis was, I think, invented. I just made this up. I think it was invented to create complex wave oscillator shapes, basically complex oscillator shapes. And if you think about this, you have a wavetable, which is like a wave sound, and you scan through it. And you have a starting wave shape, and you have an ending oscillator shape, and then you scan or morph through different states of this shape. And sometimes you have multiple oscillator shapes inside this wavetable and so on. So you have more, you have a broader range of oscillator shapes you can choose from. And this is perfectly fine when you basically, or maybe inside Cubase or some other VST host where you have no other instruments or other possibilities to create interesting sounds. But inside Bitwig here, of the Polygrid, for instance, you can use different multiple oscillators, route them into each other, and morph and twist oscillator shapes in all kinds of infinite possible directions. Alright. And you can create so interesting and so complex shapes already without wavetable. Wavetable synthesis actually is pretty constraining compared to what you have inside Bitwig already with the oscillator possibilities. So I think you imprison yourself by stuck with the older synthesis form, and it's actually not a good, that's not good to say, but I say it anyway. Nobody outside of your working environment would say, oh well, you made this with Serum, please make it with the grid, or vice versa. You made this with the grid, I can hear it, please use Serum, it sounds so much better when you actually use this completely distorted bass sound inside Serum, it would sound so much better. Nobody would say that. It all comes down to how you want to sound and how you can achieve that sound. And for instance, I know a lot of people that switches gear all the time, or use different work environments, use different samples and so on, but they are always sound the same. I can always say, yes, this is this producer, this is this artist and so on. It's astounding that they always come up with the same sound in different tools, in different with different samples, and yeah, they have basically. All that matters is the result, what you hear, and how you tweak it to fit that sound. For instance, when you have the sampler and use a wavetable inside the sampler of Bitwig, outside the grid, and you have this anti-aliasing that sounds horrible. Maybe, but if you make an acid track and you need distortion anyway at the end, it doesn't matter, right? So it depends on the context you use stuff, right? So yeah, that's what I want to say. Let it go. Don't be so obsessed with recreating different plugins inside Bitwig. It actually limits you, because Bitwig itself is an instrument for me. It creates interesting stuff. Try new stuff. If we have now a lot of people recreating stuff that we already know, it's good. I don't want to stop anyone from doing that. That's not my point. But when you are a musician and try something new. Just be playful and throw things together. This is basically like a Lego. It's I don't know how to an analogy for that. It's like having a box of Lego stones, bricks, of Lego bricks, and then building always the same car or the same stuff you already know. That's so limiting. Just try new stuff. So this was my intention, I think, for this video. Let it go. The other thing with let it go is also with plugins. There are some plugins that try to recreate a real device, but I would say the majority of people don't know how the real device would sound. So like I creating a sound inside Bitwig, and then I use a compressor, emulation of a real device compressor. But I don't know how this real compressor sound with this sound in this context. I don't know, because it doesn't have this real device in my studio. So I have to trust this emulation that it sounds correct, right? And you can say there's a difference when you use the same sound with the plug-in and with the analog device. You can compare it and say, oh, well, this one sounds better than the other. But in the real world, you have such a comparison. You don't have it. It's basically just a made-up example. That's not gonna happen. So nobody knows what you use in your working environment, only yourself. It's just for you to feel good, to have actually these real haptic interface here, and it looks like you're turning a real knob, and you have these analog meters here, and it looks good, so it has to sound good. So it's more like for your brain, that your brain feels good. But when I sent you a track and use this plug-in here or this compressor, you can't distinguish what I used, where and why and how. So you can't say it. It's basically only for you as a producer to feel good to have such a device inside your track. And I don't have to tell you about plug-in hell, where you go to different deals all the time, buying certain plugins, use it one or two times, and then never again. And you basically collect a stockpile of thousands of plugins, and you always say, wow, this sounds good, and I have to use this one this time, and this is nice for drums. Oh, this is great for distortion, and this is not so great, but this sounds good on that. I think that's only in your brain. That's not really a real world. It happens only in your brain for you to feel good. And sometimes that's good enough. It's okay. If you need something to feel good inside your working process, then do it. And but I want to make a point with this video about let it go. Sometimes It's just in your brain, and you can still use stuff inside Bitwig, for instance, and create pretty interesting complex sounds just by letting it go and play around with the stuff and be happy with the result. So that's my point about that. And yesterday I watched a video from someone who said, put a name on a workflow I do for years now, and he called it iterative refinement. And by that he basically mean that you create drafts or start a track, and you make a 1 hour or 2 hour session, and then you bounce it down to audio, save the project, and then you go on with your life and maybe start a new draft and start a new draft, new song, new track, new sample session, and so on. And weeks later you come back to that project and you hear your rendering and say, that was not so, that's a nice idea I had there, and but the drum sounds a bit not so right, so I have to correct the drums, and then it will be maybe a nice track to finish, right? And I'm doing that for now for years, that I basically on the week I pump out different drafts, small loops, sometimes completely random. I go basically through all the genres, all styles of music, and create stuff and save it in my rendering folder here. And weeks later I come back, listen to it, and maybe I finish it. And with this track, for example, I put a lot of different patterns. Like, you know, when you create a song, you have an intro and you have a middle part, an end part, and something more. Né? So I have put all these different stuff into a small space. So it's more like sometimes what I create is more like a sample library for a track. So I can go in, scrap out all the parts I really like, build something new, or just polish some sounds, stretch out arrangement, or something like that. And you always have something you can start or you can advance from. So you never have a blank page. But sometimes you feel like, oh, I need a blank page and I create something, but I have already two tracks, I have to finish them. So you go completely against your mood, basically, and push yourself to finish something you don't want to finish at the moment. So that's don't feel bad about having much started tracks. For me, it's I kind of started to appreciate that and create multiple small drafts and loops I can advance from someday later. It's not a bad thing, I think. What you have to do, at least, is to finish something at some point. It doesn't matter how long it takes, but that's another thing I want to talk about now, is it's also about let it go. This is also about let it go. Let it go, just make what your mood says it's right at the moment. So if you have, if you want to make a loop, do a loop, and so on. Another thing about let it go is with sounds, make decisions. I see a lot of people that want to have the VST and the MIDI file as long as possible till the end of a project in their project, because they want to tweak it later on. So you start like tweaking all the stuff, but music is happens in a contextual way. So when you change the bass, the drums doesn't sound right. So you tweak the drums, then the bass is wrong again. You tweak again the bass, and you can do this for weeks, right? So you have to make a decision. These are now my drums. Now I tweak the bass, and that's it. So a lot of these things are also about making decisions. And that's also about let it go. Make sounds as good as possible for you, then let it go, bounce it down, delete the MIDI file, the VST file, just for the learning process, and then try to create stuff with that that you have. And if you don't like a baseline or something, then delete it and make another baseline just from the scratch. Make just a better one, right? So if something sounds bad, delete it and make just a better one. And it's also a training to create something, and it's a process to learn to let go certain stuff, make decisions. And that's basically 90% of working or creating tracks is these brain things, like making decisions and letting stuff go. And all the rest is basically it doesn't matter so much what to use. You can make use with an Casio keyboard, or you can again take a guitar and make a complete track out of it. You can play drums on the guitar. You can make music with everything. The device doesn't matter. It's just all in your head. Use what you have, make decisions, and let it go. And I think I'm closing this video here, because I can talk about that for hours, because it's like a bit like philosophy. But and I would say I'm not always right with all my points I made, but I want to give some ideas for thoughts. So thanks for watching, and I'll see you again in the next video. Bye.